comparison. Mm-hmm.
We had the governor on, kind of continuing on with this. We had the governor on a few weeks ago, and we had asked him a bit about election reform and if this was an indicator, if this election was an indicator that maybe the process needs to be changed. And his attitude was, not that he gave us an absolute no, but his attitude was basically, these are the kind of things that are going to happen. These are the kind of things that we have the courts in place for, that even if you have, there is no such thing, I guess, when you're dealing with human beings, there is no such thing as a perfect system. Aren't we almost kind of going back and kind of retreading over something without offering any type of real solutions to that?
Well, a couple of solutions, I think, and I testified at a citizen jury meeting yesterday dealing with election reforms. And what I said is that there needs to be clear, uniform standards on how absentee ballots are handled, and there has to be a training mechanism, and there has to be some enforcement mechanism to require secretaries of state who fail to live up to their obligation to administer elections. There has to be some oversight that either the legislature or someone else can put in there, mm-hmm. to force them to properly train county election officials, for them to properly administer these elections. Ultimately, yeah. I think we have the resources we need, mm-hmm. And I know Secretary of State Ritchie and others want to add kind of new tools to the election drawer of things that we can do. I think clearly when we have the level of frustration there is about how the current process was run, I don't feel this is now the time to be adding new tools in. I think we need to be reexamining and auditing, in essence, more aggressively what was done, and making sure we have a process by which, in particular, that we have elected officials in the office of the Secretary of State that are doing what they can to administer elections and taking their statutory responsibility, which is to administer this recount. That's where we feel Secretary of State Ritchie failed miserably.
So what you're saying that he did not follow his basic oath of office.
I'm saying that Secretary of State Ritchie had a statutory responsibility to administer this recount. And what he did throughout this process is he decentralized and deputized that authority out to other people. And it created a process by which there were confusing standards and confusing mm-hmm. rules.
Wouldn't that be a place then, though, through the legislator, make alterations to the process? If this stuff is going on, and you're not the first person to bring this issue up with us, if this type of thing is going on, it's affecting the outcome of an election, wouldn't our best practice, rather than running an ad that highlights embarrassment, wouldn't our best practice then be to put pressure and put an ad out there to say, call your state legislator and tell them we need change in the state of Minnesota?
Sure, absolutely. I'll be very clear with you. We're going to do both approach. But I will tell you that Secretary of State Ritchie saw the same advantage in terms of communicating with these delegates and these other Secretary of States that were coming to Minnesota when he wrote a very out of op-ed, mm-hmm. where he was touting what he believed his successes of the recount. I just want to communicate this and be very clear. There are Minnesotans who cast ballots that were not, these ballots did not count.
Sure.
And Secretary of State Ritchie played a role in having these ballots not counted. And that's unfortunate. And for him to write an op-ed where he is, in essence, praising, in essence, his conduct during the recount, I think is just shameful. The ballots that didn't count because of his decision to flip-flop on absentee ballots, his decision to flip-flop on the standards of those, that created a situation by which we would argue that ballots in this state didn't count, that they were legally cast ballots. Ritchie saw that opportunity
yeah.
to communicate with his delegates and those attendees, I should say, to the National Secretaries of State Conference. We saw the same opportunity, and we took it.
Is there a system that you've ever an election system anywhere else in the world, not only in the United States, but in the world that you've seen that gives 100% of the legally cast ballots the opportunity to be counted? Because I think that, you know, this stuff kind of goes on. These close calls or these judgment calls are made regularly. It typically doesn't affect the outcome of an election. I got to wonder, is the mission of 100% votes counted, is that achievable?
I think it has to be achievable, and I think it has to be all of our goal. Look, I choose to participate in a process and volunteer my time to engage in a process by which I want to see all ballots cast.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to win elections by excluding people's legally cast ballots. I want our candidates to win because they have the right idea, the right message, and the right candidates. That being said, while I don't think there is necessarily a 100% perfect system, I will tell you that at the end of the day, people there is a chief election officer in this state, and we need to make sure that we're electing people that have the integrity and the decision-making authority and the right, I would venture to say, the right kind of framework on the issue of democracy, that when they're in that office, they're going to act as a nonpartisan, and they're going to be an aggressive advocate for ballots being cast, not just of their political party, mm-hmm. but of the opposite political party. And what we have seen consistently from the Republican perspective is a Secretary of State who is completely uninterested in being an advocate for election integrity, and he's uninterested in being a champion for Republican candidates and ensuring that Republican ballots are counted.
Why did the state Supreme Court then disagree with that?
I can't speak to that. As I said, I'm not an attorney. I've never even played one on TV. I just don't have any role in the judicial process. My role here is purely as a partisan and to speak for, I think, the countless of activists across the state that cast ballots that were excluded due to a system that was, in essence, helped created by an overly partisan and a Secretary of State that's just not interested in preserving democracy.
And, Michael, you've indicated that this will continue, or at least the article does. The ad campaign will continue right up until November. How big of an issue is this going to be for the GOP as they get elected in November? And do you think that Minnesota voters will have fatigue on it?
Look, this is going to be a two-pronged approach. I hope our candidates for Secretary of State discuss issues like election integrity. And look, I moved a few years ago. In order to get a video card, in order to get a library card, I had to show a photo ID. I think an election integrity issue here that this Secretary of State has consistently ignored and has been championed by Republican organizations and conservative groups has been photo ID and requiring someone to show a photo ID in order to cast a ballot. We're going to talk about those positive election integrity issues. But just as Secretary of State Ritchie did in 2006 when he ran, we would argue to be one of the most negative campaigns for Secretary of State, using a variety of out-of-state financial resources, a really scorched-earth campaign, we're going to have a very frank conversation and a very aggressive ad campaign about his record as Secretary of State, the record of his decisions that we would argue led to the disenfranchisement of countless Minnesotans in an election process that was decided by 312 votes.
Michael Brodkorb, who is the deputy GOP chairman, thank you for your time, Michael.
Thank you so much for the opportunity.
You bet. It's 11:49.